What's up, off-worlders? Welcome to another magical episode.
Magical?
Of Off-World Off-Topic.
with
me, Sam Paler, and Mark Fox Powell.
Hello.
Off-World Off-Topic is Off-World Empire's weekly show. Mark.
Yes.
I've been thinking about my Oculus pre-order a bit.
Oh, yeah.
I want to keep it.
Oh, are you thinking of cancelling it?
Well, no. Maybe. And no. I'll tell you why.
You know, I'm relying on you to sort me out with some VR.
No, but there's a reason. There's a specific reason.
Okay.
The VR's still on the table. Still on the cards.
Okay,
It's just because the more I hear about this, the Vive...
Oh,
the more I'm like, maybe... Maybe I want that. So basically, I heard recently that... Do you remember when we talked about it last time? We talked about the field of view of it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I couldn't work out if the field of view was different. It's because it says that it was like 110 degrees.
Yeah.
But people were saying it seems bigger in the Vive.
Right.
But the more I've like heard about it recently, it seems like it has like a taller field of view. So the field of view on the sides is the same, but it's got taller, and that seems to make like a difference.
Right.
And so wearing the Oculus feels a bit more sort of narrow.
A little bit like you're looking through something.
Yeah.
Like a little window or something.
And I kind of really want that. That sounds like a more immersive...
It does.
...kind of thing that I want. The only difference is potentially... I can't work out what the kind of screen door effect, that kind of like mesh that you get over the image, is like on the HTC Vive compared to the Oculus. I don't really want that.
That's going to be more of an issue than the field of view, don't you think?
This is the thing, I have to decide between the two. Mm. To be honest, it's gonna come down to, in the end, which one, the cost is different.
Yeah.
So if the HTC Vive is like £1,000, I'm like, obviously, no.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true, actually.
So I'll wait. The pre-orders open fairly soon.
Mm. And you get the room scale stuff. I mean, not that that's really going to be
usable. I can't really use that particularly.
But it is kind of cool just to have the capability of doing it.
Yeah, I mean,
it
does
sound
cool.
You could take it somewhere.
Cool.
Or like if you move somewhere that's got a bigger like living room or something, it could be... Could be kind of cool,
but I can't quite decide. It's gonna more information is gonna help me decide.
Yeah,
but I might just keep the Oculus pre-order though, just in the case that like I could buy it and then I could, but it's a bit risky. But I could sell it potentially on eBay for some monies because I'll have it quite early.
Does that work? Can you sell the pre-order?
Don't know. Don't know if you can do that. But like the fact that I'll have it in April, like
you might have two VR headsets.
Yeah, but then I wouldn't keep both of them though.
No.
I don't know. We'll see. I definitely need some VR in my life.
Oh yeah, for sure.
We'll see. We shall see.
Cool.
Right.
So
are we doing this week first?
This week we're going to be talking about abandoning Earth. Abandoned ship.
Yeah.
So under what circumstances might we actually decide that we need to leave Earth forever?
Yeah.
And all the joyous stuff that goes along with that.
Yeah, so like the reasons why we might have to leave Earth, where we could go, we might do it.
Yeah,
all these kinds of things. Like any issues that come up, like moral issues related to that.
Should be fun.
But first, we had some user comments again.
Yeah, we've had some comments, yeah.
As the weeks have gone on. I think we're going to talk about one today, just because...
Yeah.
Just to save time. But we're going to keep doing these every week.
So keep
writing in.
Definitely keep the comments coming. Love it.
So we did single stage to orbit.
Yes. Last week.
Single stage to orbit and other crazy ways of like the future of getting into space.
Yeah.
And someone, Jamie Gooden, wrote a comment on one of our videos pointing out that we hadn't discussed escape dynamics. And I was like, okay, I don't know. I've never heard of that.
Absolutely never
heard
of
that. Don't know what it was.
So thanks for pointing that out.
Yeah. And I basically read off on it, as did you.
Yeah.
And it sounds pretty nuts.
It's a crazy idea.
And I thought it'd be quite
really
good to discuss quickly.
Yeah, definitely. Quite different to any of the other stuff we discussed.
Yeah, it's like a totally different design in that you don't have most of your energy on board. You have it on the ground in kind of like a microwave emitter. And that you fly this plane up.
Yeah.
That has kind of like it would eventually convert to hydrogen, but you're testing with helium.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. Get better specific impulse and thrust, I think, with with hydrogen.
Okay.
I don't know why they built the prototype with helium, but essentially all it is like the engine is essentially just a container that contains the gas, a turbo pump which pumps out the gas, and then a heat exchanger which absorbs the microwave energy being emitted from like some
like a ground station,
super powerful microwave emitter on the ground, which then absorbs that heat and you know, uses the fuel, burns the fuel, whatever, and then it comes out at the back as thrust.
So is it? It's literally just hot helium or hot gas that creates
seemingly,
the thrust.
Yeah.
And that's more efficient than like ignited fuel, the burning fuel.
I don't know if it's... Well, it's...
It seems to... I mean, the specific impulse with like the measure of efficiency is much higher with this thing.
True.
In theory, than it is for like, chemical rockets.
But the,
where it sort of is...
But it's not necessarily the overall efficiency. Because, like,
you're
getting your energy from the ground. I imagine you lose loads of your energy.
Yeah, yeah, probably.
In the transition. So the efficiency might not be, but the specific impulse would be higher.
Yeah, specific impulse, which is specifically about propellant. Yeah. Like, the amount of propellant you need for the amount of thrust you get.
And because you don't carry a lot of your energy on board.
Yeah.
You don't have so much weight. So you can get into single stage to orbit that way.
Mm-hmm. It seems like there's a lot of crazy... Like, what happens if something flies in the path of your microwave beam you're emitting?
Another plane just gets fried.
Does it get like lasered in half by a microwave maser, which is a microwave laser?
Probably.
I don't really know. Or no, a bird or something.
It might be. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what like frequency they do it. I guess it'd have to be reabsorbed
like
by something.
Get a bird fly through the beam, and you just end up with like a roast chicken.
just fall just out, falls of the out sky. The sky. Just.
And also,
like, imagine it like burning holes in clouds. Just like,
would it do that? I don't
probably
know.
Probably not.
I'm not sure. I just don't know. I mean, this is such a crazy idea. Well, I mean, wireless power has obviously been something that's been talked about for a while. This kind of thing.
Yes.
Not using it as like a propeller, like to power a single stage orbit craft. I've never heard that before. But like the concept of being able to beam power from like a solar panel like in space back down to the Earth and stuff like that. Something people have been talking
about. Yeah, like a laser or something.
Yeah. But so that's not totally new, but this like as an idea of like a propelling a vehicle this way is like
new. Yeah, I've never heard of it.
I wonder if it decreases with efficiency with distance.
Probably. There's just more atmosphere to go through eventually. Obviously, they get to a point where it's in orbit and it's just, I don't know. Actually, in orbit, do you still give it the bits of microwave? How do you do that?
I don't know. Maybe you'd have, like an orbital station that you've put up,
like relays.
Yeah, you could have an orbital station which generates these microwaves as well and, like, powers the thing on orbit, maybe. I don't know. Otherwise, you're just going to end up having to take a load of fuel with you to do, like, other manoeuvres once you're up in orbit.
Yeah.
Which negates the whole point of having a, like, the light.
That's true.
Externally powered.
Yeah, I don't really know. But anyway, it looks like it's not going to be a real thing now.
Yeah, so, despite all the stuff we've been chatting about, it looks like the company have discontinued all of their R&D as of basically like a month ago.
Yeah.
Just to do with like costs.
They ran out of money essentially, and they think that the payback times are too long and stuff for developers and these types of things. So it's a shame. That sounds like, I mean, to be honest, it sounds like quite an outside idea. But,
yeah.
It's a shame, but you know, these things happen. And I guess it's put that idea out in kind of a bit more detail in case anyone else picks it up and decides they've done some maths and they think that actually is still the best way.
So yeah.
I guess that's a good thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's not really going to be... Chances are that's not going to be a way that we're going to get into single stage to orbit in the near future. It looks like it's far less likely than a lot of the other stuff we discussed last week, like the Skylon.
No, but they did actually have a prototype of the thruster.
But it was basic, though. And the thruster for producing wasn't much.
And obviously it was on the ground. I mean, they weren't flying anything.
Yeah.
But, in terms of like the principle of it, like using the energy beamed from a microwave source with an antenna to like a heat exchanger that was remote and then causing some kind of thrust, that was actually demonstrated. So you know, maybe if there is something in it, it'll get picked up again in a decade or something.
Yeah.
I don't know. Who knows?
Yeah. Who knows?
But it was definitely interesting. I'd never heard of it, so that was cool.
So thank you for the suggestion.
Right.
Main topic.
I think. Let's move on to the main topic.
Yeah. So.
So here's a scenario.
Yeah.
Everything is fucked. All right.
The Earth is in some kind of peril.
Yeah.
So, I think what we first need to kind of think about is, under what circumstances would we actually have to leave?
Yeah.
Earth?
Yeah.
You think about certain things and things like climate change. Okay. So as in us adding CO2 to the atmosphere. Is that ever going to be enough that we would actually totally have to abandon
literally
Earth?
Have to leave Earth?
Yeah, to get it, to
I don't know.
And things like say like a super volcano eruption that's not like a cataclysm, like
not like the whole surface of the Earth like overturning.
Yeah, like Venus or something.
Venus, that would be ridiculous.
Yeah, but like a Yellowstone type eruption or whatever. Would we still decide to leave Earth under those circumstances? Because obviously, that's it's going to take an extraordinary amount of effort and danger and everything to get everyone, or get as many people as we can, or move the human race. Or, I mean, maybe that's a totally unrealistic thing ever to happen anyway.
What, move the entire human race?
Yeah.
Well, we'll kind of get onto
that in
a bit.
Moral issues and stuff.
Yeah, I think that maybe that is a bit of a stretch. That would never really truly happen.
Yeah.
But in terms of like things that would drive us to leave, I think even like really horrendous cataclysmic climate change
would
be easier
to try
to rehouse ourselves or try and reverse it. So it's either to like, I don't know, like go underground or something, build habitat somewhere else on Earth, move to the poles, for example, if it gets really hot.
Yeah.
Things like that would be easier. I mean, still a bit of a nightmare, but easier than trying to leave Earth entirely.
Yeah.
And like abandoning it.
Yeah, I think I agree. There's not many circumstances in which I can think in when we would have to just totally abandon Earth.
Mm.
But there are some.
There are some. And actually, before we dive into the more recent stuff, obviously, like, we will have to leave Earth eventually anyway if we survive long enough.
Yeah.
I mean, billions of years in the future.
Yeah. So if civilization goes along that far, then eventually the sun's going to get massive.
Yeah.
And
so we're not talking about that necessarily. Things that are probably on the shorter term.
Yeah.
So it's inevitable at some point that we will have to leave if we're still around.
Yeah. So if we think about, say, let's think about sort of existential risk problems, really, that kind of come in and could threaten humanity in a way that we would have to transplant at least a large part of humanity off the Earth.
Yeah, yeah.
So asteroid impacts. So let's say we discover an asteroid and... So we're also going to talk about these things, like how we might do this in terms of how much lead time we get in realizing we're going to have to leave Earth or whatever.
Which massively depends on the type of like destruction we're facing.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
So like an asteroid impact, we probably wouldn't have a very long lead time.
Probably not.
Because if we had a very long lead time, we might be able to. We'd probably be able to do something about it.
Yeah,
to be honest.
Actually, that's true. Yeah. So in terms of an asteroid impact that's likely to make us leave the Earth, we'd have to have detected it on a very short timescale.
Yeah.
So otherwise, yeah, you're right. Like, it's much easier to try and do something about the asteroid, and there are plans in place to like.
Yeah.
Well, people talk about plans.
I think moving an asteroid is. I mean, it's obviously very difficult, but it's way in our capabilities.
Yeah.
As like, now. If the entire human race was like, we've got to sort this out, otherwise everyone's going to die.
Yeah.
And we would do that.
Yeah.
It makes sense, but of course we might see it too late. But then we have an extremely short lead time into.
And then it gets interesting.
And then the other thing is, like, depending on the size of the asteroid, if it's an absolutely massive asteroid, then we probably will have detected it further away.
Yeah.
Whereas there's like, obviously there's kind of like a hole in there somewhere where the asteroid is big enough to cause like really big harm, but small enough not to have been detected early, or it's kind of, you know.
But I still feel like I don't think the discussion of leaving Earth forever would be one that we have if we detected an asteroid too late. I think all of the Earth's resources would be pulled into trying to stop it, or to try and move it, or break it up, or something like that, rather than actually trying to leave the Earth.
That's possibly
forever.
True. Yeah.
Because that's a bigger undertaking.
Yeah.
Like, there's so many other things you have to know, like where you're going, all this stuff that we'll go on.
There just wouldn't be time.
There wouldn't be time, exactly. So
so you just
whole world would band together. I totally agree, but it would be an effort to try and, I don't know, do something about it, like fly Bruce Willis up there or something.
Yeah, exactly. Get Bruce on it.
Much more likely, actually, gradually change the orbit of the asteroid and steer it away from the Earth, which is.
But if you detect it too late and that's not an option, you try and break it into smaller pieces, so some of it burns up or
it'd
whatever.
It'd be horrendous, actually. Yeah. Imagine that, like, because we're probably talking about, I don't know, like weeks or months or something like that.
Yeah,
like not very long from detection to known impact, and it's like. We've got to try something. We don't know if it's going to work.
Yeah.
I mean, that would be terrible. But I'm not sure it would be something that would drive us to leave the Earth. Certainly could be an existential risk. Like, certainly that asteroid impacts are capable of, like, totally sterilizing the Earth if they're big enough.
Yeah.
Which is a crazy thought.
Yeah, they'll definitely. So, in that sense, our thoughts about abandoning and leaving Earth, part of me doesn't think an asteroid maybe comes into that then, after we've just discussed it. I can't see many scenarios in which we would try and actually leave Earth in order to get round that problem. Every scenario I can think of, we either try and deflect the asteroid.
Yeah.
and or it's too late and we just do whatever we can, because we aren't going to be able to like move half the human race into like a safe kind of you know interstellar kind of transport system in the time we've got.
No, maybe there would be, if we had enough time, there would be some kind of push to build like a spacecraft that just contains some human embryos or something.
Oh right, yeah.
Just
maybe.
Like send it off, as well as trying to deflect the asteroid.
Yeah.
As like a just an absolute last ditch attempt to keep the human race alive.
Yeah. Just some frozen embryos that we hope get like, reanimated by something.
And shove it out into like a Voyager probe. I mean, that's almost certainly nothing's gonna come of that.
And the viability of those would decrease over time.
Yeah.
The chances are they would be in interstellar space for like
billions of years.
Yeah, probably.
Still though,
without radiation, without that much kind of radiation shielding, relatively compared.
Yeah.
Anyway, maybe.
Maybe, but
maybe you could do that. You could do something like that, like a life raft for human genetics, or the human race.
Mm.
So yeah, let's. So maybe asteroids actually aren't on the list then.
Yeah, maybe not.
So something else, things like gamma ray bursts, again, maybe also not on the list, because we're going to probably end up. Well, actually, maybe there would be. So a gamma ray burst is like a super energetic kind of... I think it's the most energetic thing we know of in the universe.
Yeah.
And there's various theories of what they come from, but they tend to be linked to things like supernovas, hypernovas, these types of things.
Mm. Just like a focused like beam of gamma rays, basically.
Yeah, yeah. In a few seconds, a gamma ray burst will release as much energy as the sun will release in its 10 billion year lifetime. So they're absolutely ridiculous. And so the idea is that if one of... But they're very rare. They only occur in... it's like a few times every million years in a whole galaxy.
Okay.
So they're very rare events.
Yeah.
But if they were focused at Earth...
Which again is really... Like, it doesn't need to be just close. It needs to be pointing at us, right?
Because they're focused... Most energy is at like a beam kind of... Mm. Then it could cause like huge destruction to the atmosphere and the biology that was exposed to it and things. Like, could strip away loads of the ozone layer and all kinds of things
like that. Well,
so the thing with the gamma ray burst is we might not know it's going to hit us until it hits us, because the speed of light but there is, I guess, one thing in that we know what types of stars have high risks of becoming supernovas and things.
Yeah.
And consequently, we might be highly suspicious that a certain star is going into that mode. We know kind of its orientation. If we know various things about it, various physical properties, then maybe its kind of direction and things tell us that there's a likely chance that we might get a huge amount of energy poured into Earth from the gamma ray burst, or from a supernova. Again, we can consider supernovas as well at this point, I suppose.
Yeah.
There's another.
There's overlaps for sure. Like, supernovas also create a load of gamma rays. I mean, gamma ray bursts could be coming from like absolutely massive supernovas.
Yeah.
Supernovas of the scale that could cause problems to the Earth happen something like 3 times in the Milky Way per century. So they're really quite common, but they have to be. They have to be like really close.
Yeah.
For them to cause any problems.
Yes. A gamma ray burst can be much further away.
Yeah.
I think.
And also the fact that we don't absolutely know what gamma ray bursts are caused by.
No, it seems to be a lot of different things cause different time ones. Some like the collision of two neutron stars or whatever.
Right.
Might cause like a different type of gamma ray burst that lasts for a different amount of time.
Yeah.
To compared to one that comes out of like a hypernova or something.
Yeah. The supernovas like it's a certain type of star at the end of its lifetime. So like stars that are like 10 times the mass of the sun or something like that, and bigger, that form supernovas. So stars like the sun don't.
Yeah.
And they have to be within something like 30 light years, less than 100 light years at least, for them to cause any problem to us. And we know that there's none within that sort of sphere of the sun now.
No.
That are likely to go supernova anytime soon.
Yes.
Like the nearest one's like 600 or so light years away, which would look cool. Like, we would, if something like, so there's apparently the star Betelgeuse, which is like 600 and something light years away, could go supernova within the next million years or so. And if that happens soonish, you know, we'll see it in the sky. But it won't cause any problems for
that
us.
That won't cause any problems?
No.
Okay. So potentially you could get, like, quite a long lead time in understanding some of these supernova or gamma ray bursts might come at you, based on the fact that, like, stars go through predictive evolutionary cycles.
Yes.
And we know kind of the different stages of different stars around the galaxy.
Yes.
And seeing them go through these lifetimes, these lifespans.
Yeah.
So you could, maybe you could say in about 100,000 or a million years, it looks like this star or these two stars are probably going to cause a huge amount of damage to the Earth.
Yeah.
And make a conscious decision then to try and avoid that. And they would you know, of course, they've damaged most of the solar system as well.
Yeah, yeah, something like a gamma ray burst as well. You'd have to, presumably, you'd have to get out. If you're going to try and get out, you'd have to try and get out a long time before it happened, because you don't want your ship to be anywhere near the gamma ray burst.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's a good. I mean, like a supernova is more of a sphere of kind of crap.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. that's right, yeah.
So you'd have to potentially go a pretty long way.
I don't know how that would work, really. I mean, if you have something like 100,000 years or 1 million years lead time, I mean, for a start, as an aside, that's quite an interesting concept to think. What would society, if we knew, if we had that date now, and we knew it, absolutely knew 100% that in let's say 100,000 years, that the surface of the Earth would become uninhabitable due to like some crazy event like that.
Yeah, just something.
We just knew that, like it was absolutely just known. Like, what would that do to society now? It's we'd be like, oh, they'll worry about that in the future. Don't worry about it now.
We know in whatever that day is, it's the end of the Mayan calendar, and we've got to get out.
I mean, sort of like, yeah. I mean, it's doomsday, you know. Like, and we know it. So, what would that do to society now? I don't know if it would do that much, really.
Well, we'd obviously just have to start actually thinking about that in the same...
Yeah.
I mean, we sort of think of climate change in that way, in the way that it's kind of like, it's in the future, the problems are starting to become, like, evident now.
Yeah.
But to everyone, it feels like it's a long way away, and so humans are kind of, like, gradually beginning to do stuff about it.
Yeah.
So maybe it would just happen in that, it probably would take a lot longer to start developing. Yeah. You'd imagine it would just be kind of bubbling under as, like, a thing we've got to do.
The difference is, of course, we don't really know what the outcome of climate change is going to be for the Earth, whereas this would be, like,
we know it's a brick wall. Yeah.
That we're
yeah, and we're driving, going to drive into it.
Yeah.
That's true, and like the, if it's gonna, whatever this thing is also gonna take out the solar system, then you've basically, again, maybe it's a generational ship. You've got to build an ark, something to get everyone off.
But you've got 100,000 years to do it.
So you've got like 10 billion people to get into space or something.
Yeah,
by that point.
Yeah, possibly.
But we talk about that when we talk about how we're gonna potentially
the social moral sort of implications,
and also how like the actual mechanical way.
Yeah,
in which you
of course. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, but anyway, so one of these massive gamma ray bursts.
Yeah.
Or I guess like the kind of sphere of gamma rays or whatever that comes out of a supernova, one of those kind of events.
Yeah.
What does it actually do to the Earth?
So obviously we don't really know, but what it will probably do is, like I said, damage the ozone layer.
Right.
Which is bad for various reasons.
Yeah.
And if it's a high enough energy one, it would cause like the death of a huge amount of just life on the side of the Earth that's exposed to it. To the point where even like Deinococcus radiodurans, which is like one of the most like radiation resistant organisms, would potentially die as well that's on the surface. But things like deep in the deep sea and the deep subsurface, or things on the other side of the Earth, would maybe not be so badly affected. But the problem is that they would have to then contend with highly damaged kind of ecosystem, biosphere, basically.
Yeah, I mean,
and an atmosphere that's highly damaged.
Yeah,
and all the kind of like, you know, knock on effects from the.
I mean, I'm sort of imagining like one half of the Earth being sort of bathed in fire. I mean, it's probably not that at all.
I don't really know.
But just high intensity radiation. But
you get some badass like auroras and probably all that sort of stuff.
It would probably look crazy. Yeah.
Maybe. You'd get sort of oxidation of all types of like different chemical species in the upper atmosphere and stuff. Probably.
And the magnetosphere would probably be like
something
interacting with it in a crazy way.
Yeah, it'd probably look cool.
But I mean, even just the removal of the ozone layer from one of these things off half of the Earth is going to have like giant repercussions throughout the entire biosphere.
Yeah,
really bad ones, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Suddenly you have like the full brunt of UV and everything piling onto the surface, like getting probably destroying shitloads of like photosynthetic organisms that the rest of the biosphere depend on.
But maybe that the ozone layer would heal itself. Not that it wouldn't take.
Yeah.
I mean, the ozone layer that we made from hydrofluorocarbons years ago is started to close.
Yeah, yeah, sure. But it would. I mean, what I'm saying is, it would be like a massively.
It'd be bad. Damaging, it'd be hugely damaging event. Yeah, yeah, it would. Yeah.
But certainly, if half of the Earth was just wiped out, apart from microbes in the deep subsurface, then you know, like, the biosphere is irreversibly screwed. Like it will bounce back in a certain way, but it will never look like it did before.
It'll take millions of years.
And it will look totally different to what it did before. It would be a different evolutionary. You know, it would go off on some other tangent. But
so there are like hypotheses that I think it's the Ordovician Silurian extinction might have been caused by a gamma ray burst. But I think it's like fringe kind of ideas.
Right.
Anyway, side point.
But the thing is, all of that stuff that you just described and we just talked about, potentially not big enough to force us to leave. If we knew it was coming and we could get everybody hidden in shelters of some kind.
Yeah.
So the fact that you can be deep enough underground to be sheltered from it.
Yeah.
So if you go underground on the opposite side of the earth.
Yeah.
Then maybe it's easier to survive it and to sort of wait it out because on Earth.
The chances of your ship getting out of the way of it in time, and that ship, if it is in it, having enough shielding to make it, you know, not damaged. Because the Earth's got loads of like magnetic fields and all this kind of stuff that might help. So maybe a gamma ray burst, you wouldn't bother. You'd just do your best to preserve humans. I mean, there's obviously a possibility that we'll already be in loads of different places or whatever.
Yeah.
But we're just considering the possibility at the moment that, like, Earth as one thing, what do we do about
humans
on there, and whether we would then actually decide the best way to save ourselves is to leave it, is to go and never come back.
Yeah, I'm not convinced we would do that. I mean, it's possible that there might be a dual effort, like, okay, let's try and sit it out here, but also as a fail safe send some people off. I mean, that's a weird thought, to like sort of split the human race in
half.
That's
cool though, but possibly.
Yeah, so maybe even a gamma ray burst possibly isn't big enough or at least if you could ever predict it. I mean, if you can't predict it, if it just hits, I mean, it could hit us right now.
Yeah, and then we just deal with the consequences.
Yeah,
like, we just have to do something about it.
Yeah.
So what other types of things then maybe?
Well,
could anything else force us off? Maybe not.
I think so. I think there's at least one thing that I can think of, natural event at least.
Yeah.
Which would be something that just totally like gravitationally perturbs the solar system.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Right, so in the sense that we were talking about this in a video a while ago, that probably in the ancient history of the solar system, there was like a reshuffling. Where like Jupiter and Saturn in some kind of resonance threw all the planets about, and like all the orbits of everything changed massively.
Yeah, probably.
Probably. Yeah. That's a decent way of explaining the way things are. Yeah. So something like, I mean, people talk about like neutron stars and things like this, like rogue objects that wander through the galaxy, moving by close enough to just gravitationally perturb everything.
Which you could not get out of the way with any other, like, any method.
I mean, if it's something as massive as a neutron star...
No, you're screwed, yeah.
You can't move that, like, unless you have some kind of crazy technology that we...
Yeah.
It's just science fiction.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's possible. You know, suddenly the Earth could be flung out to like the orbit of like Neptune or the orbit of Mercury or something like that, like smash into Jupiter or something. I don't know, who knows,
you'd probably be able to model its like trajectory and then model what it would do, but chances are most of the solar system would be fucked.
Yeah.
To be honest,
and we know that the conditions, or at least it seems like the conditions of on the Earth, are really like finely balanced, like the kind of the situation we're in is a result of our like exactly where we are, distance from the sun, the fact that the moon's where it is, and all this other stuff, possibly even like where Jupiter is, has a massive effect on like the Earth's sort of ecosystem and environment being the way it is.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Yeah.
So you move that stuff around, things are going to change, not just a little bit. You know, the Earth probably end up looking like Mercury or something.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, you know? Exactly. Or like frozen, like Pluto or something. Just like
totally uninhabitable.
And then every other, you know, all the close by planets would potentially be slung out to random places.
Yeah.
So then, you know, that in that situation, and you might get, again, you might get a long lead time.
Yes.
You might see that coming from a long way away.
Yeah.
And then have time to react to it.
And be able to model exactly what's going to happen, as you were saying. So we'd know a lot about it. And
that's a situation where, yeah, you would potentially think about, we've got to get we've got to get as many people as we can off the Earth. And whatever, and to preserve humanity and preserve what part of the biosphere we can, or
whatever,
Noah it.
Yeah, essentially.
two
elephants, two mosquitoes. Actually, no, screw the mosquitoes.
I've just thought of another one.
Yeah,
mosquitoes.
Why did I think of mosquitoes?
Tangent.
Yeah.
Potentially important to the biosphere. Obviously important to like the actual ecosystem of the biosphere and stuff. But the fucking pieces of shit.
Oh yeah, little bastards.
I would quite happily get rid of them.
I mean, they're annoying, but much more importantly, they're responsible for like the deaths of a hell of a lot of people.
Yeah.
It's probably the big... Is malaria the biggest killer?
Probably.
I think it's one off. It's one off.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway, little shits.
Yeah.
But if you...
Whereas the viruses them, they're carrying, it's not their fault. They just want to get a tasty
malaria.
Blood meal.
Malaria a virus? I don't think it is. I'm not sure what it is, actually.
I can't remember.
Anyway.
There are viruses they carry.
Tangent alert.
yeah, forget that. So I just had a thought then when you were talking. Another way then, potentially, we would have to get the hell out of Earth is if we did something bad.
Well, yeah.
So we talked about climate change, which is, you know, human-induced. But there's obviously worse, potentially worse things we could do. Things that would change the surface of the Earth completely.
Mm.
Things like development of AI or something like that. Mm. In which, like, there's a runaway AI, we can't do anything about it, and we just decide to get, just to bail.
Just literally, but the chances, leg it.
Unless that AI's express goal is to try and kill us, it might not follow us, in the sense that if it has, like, so this is, I don't know how far to go down this road, because you kind of have to explain a lot of stuff to get to the point where this makes some sense. But anyway,
just try it anyway.
There's some scenarios in which potentially an AI could be very, like, specifically interested in a very like mundane goal,
mm-hmm.
And it tries to complete that goal and gets better and better at completing it. And anything that stands in its way, it just, like, is just removing because it, you know, it's slowing down its efficiency.
Yeah, so it might see
the human
race as just like something in the way of its goal.
Yeah, that's trying to stop. So if we left Earth, it doesn't really care because we've gone and we're not in its way and it can carry on doing whatever its basic task is. So it wouldn't chase us in that sense. If it expressly did want to kill us, then we'd just be fucked.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to actually imagine a situation where an AI would specifically want to kill us, actually.
Yeah, but this is a totally different...
This is a totally different topic, and we're not going to go into it too much now, because we will be doing videos on it.
Yeah, we will be doing an AI thing. Anyway, yeah, so something like that, or, like, I don't know...
Like nuclear war or something.
Yeah, but that's going to happen real fast, and the people that are going to be doing the nuclear war are probably going to be the people that are going to have the resources to get everyone off the Earth.
Mm.
Like, big... Like, you need, like, huge governments kind of just, like... I don't know, for some reason they just decide, two of them decide, we want to not just nuke each other, we want to cover the entire surface of the Earth in, like, radioactive melting lava. just scour the surface.
Yeah.
And they're the people that are going to have the resources to build to take us, you know, on an interstellar journey.
Yeah.
So, but there are potentially, something like AI is kind of a far-flung idea, of course.
I do still wonder, even I mean, AI, yes, but I do still wonder with stuff like nuclear war and things, whether, like, the fact that we talk about living on the surface of Mars in colonies, that's a pretty horrible place to live, but we talk about living there. So like a totally irradiated wasteland of an Earth would still be a viable place to live with enough technology. So I still don't think, as you were saying, we just come to the same conclusion. I still don't think it would be a thing that we'd leave the Earth for.
Yeah.
AI maybe.
Quite possibly. I'm not sure if there's many others I can think of, really.
It's possible, like experiment, like, this is a bit wacky, but like sort of experiments that go wrong. I mean, some kind of biotech disaster, maybe.
It's like a technological
disaster. Like, so say like some kind of super virus or something is released that we just can't get rid of. It's just everywhere. Like.
Yeah, the thing is, it would have to be something really unusual, because every virus we know of has, like, a specific kind of cycle in which it decimates, like, a large portion of its host, and then
as you quarantine that area or quarantine the people who have it, you can eventually...
And even if you don't, there's still inevitably some people who survive it, etc. Maybe people would say, like, it's too much risk, we've got to, you know, it's killing, like, 95% of the population, it already has done in wherever it started. So it starts in, like, Asia or something, and it kills all of, like, Europe and everything around that continent, and then, like, US and South America, kind of a distance away from it, decide to shut off all the, like, you know, travel and stuff back and forth to those places. The whole of half the world, like, dead, and they just decide it's inevitably going to come here. We've got to bail.
Yeah.
Still pretty unlikely.
It's quite a stretch to imagine.
It's quite a stretch.
To imagine that. Like, it doesn't seem like something that would happen. But maybe something like a virus is too sort of familiar to think about. Maybe just like some kind of weird, like, self-replicating element. It wouldn't even have to be biological. Sort of like a grey goo scenario, and where you have something that's just, like, systematically trying to turn...
Okay, so that's, like, towards the AI.
Towards the AI thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to necessarily be AI in the same sense, though. It could just be something that's trying to turn all the biological matter into copies of itself or something like that.
Yeah.
Which is kind of like crossover between a virus and an AI, yeah, weirdly. Just like nanobots or even like little protein, like, yeah, I don't know, whatever.
And we'd hope, I would just say, we would hope around this time we're like developing, like where AI takes over, whatever, that we've already got some kind of insurance policies around, but we'll talk about that in a sec, as in like other people living in other star systems and stuff. But in terms of, yeah, getting people off Earth,
yeah,
then, yeah, possibly a, maybe, a great,
yeah, I think you have to make a bit of an imagination leap to try and imagine these scenarios.
For a lot of them, you do.
Yeah,
and that we're like, we're literally abandoning Earth. We're not. It's not that like we're planning to come back. It's that, yeah, it's that like that this is the Earth is. It's
that's
screwed.
It. Yeah, yeah. We're leaving it for good. Like we're basically just forgetting about it, abandoning it forever.
Yeah,
it's quite hard to imagine a scenario in which that might happen.
But there's a few. There's a few. Like,
there's a few. Yeah.
And then obviously there's the inevitable. The sun is going to die.
Yes, as we said at the beginning. I mean, obviously one day we're gonna have to do it anyway.
Yeah.
Regardless of what else happens, if any, none of these things happen. It's not the Earth has a lifetime,
yeah.
So we're gonna have to leave it at some point. So saying one of these scenarios does actually happen.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, how do we do it? How do we actually get out of here? And
yeah,
where would we go?
Yeah, I guess you need to sort of think about that in terms of like different time points in a way.
So
because
yeah,
because like those things are going to be determined by how long you have as a lead time in knowing. And
yes,
at what
point
in your development you are.
Yes, yeah, also a very good point.
So if it's like right now, we might have to use what we've got kind of thing, and we get a very short lead time.
Yeah.
If it's, you know, much further in the future.
You mean the event, we find out now that an event is going to happen like way in the future.
Yeah. Then you've got, you know, a potential technology. You don't know what changes in technology you might have.
Yeah,
so
sure.
There's kind of two scenarios there.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah,
you have a short lead time or not particularly long, and that you end up having time to... One, you have time to plan. One, you have no time to plan, but you end up using recognisable technology.
Yeah.
And one in which you have no time to plan, but it happens at a time when there's, like, ridiculous... We don't know what sorts of technology, and we can just speculate about that.
Yeah.
And also, the best scenario being, it happens in a highly technologically advanced time, and we get a long lead time as well.
Yeah, which that's the best-case scenario.
That's the best-case scenario, and actually, maybe that's more likely...
It might be the most likely scenario, actually.
More likely in the sense that...
just statistically likely.
Yeah, and also in the sense that of those two future scenarios... When we've got a very good technology, the chances that we would know about something long time before might be much higher than
that's
not knowing about it.
A very good point, yeah.
So if we consider that first one, then
so like short lead time happening relatively soon in the basically in our current like state of development,
yeah,
and like a lead time of like I don't know like
well anything from now
anything from like almost instantaneous like days
to like 50 years
yeah okay 50 years yeah or that's still hardly anything really on the grand scheme of thing
yeah. So we'd obviously in the if it happens instantly, in any scenario be able to do anything?
I mean, it's really hard to imagine. You know, it would require such like a massive cooperation effort over the whole world that if it's literally like days away or weeks away or something, then maybe not.
Yeah,
you just sort of. Get as many people as possible, whatever the event's going to be, get as many people as possible like into like a bunker or something that already exists and just like hope everything's going to be fine.
Yeah.
Because like building a ship or something to take people away is not something you can do in a few days or weeks.
No, and you think about all the conventional technology we have. Sure, we've got like capabilities to get people into orbit, but like you've got to build something that's going to then... Well, I mean, it depends what the event is, because if it's something that's going to like wipe out the solar system as well... Then like we haven't got anything that we're basically screwed.
We're basically screwed.
You can't. You're not gonna be able to build like a generational ship in like you know a short period of time.
No.
Or use any of the conventional technology we have at the moment to create something like that. We'd have to spend years of development.
But say we have like as you said 50 years or even less, but like say on the order of like 10 to 20 years or something like that in that kind of range.
Yeah.
Where it is feasible to develop. You know, missions can get developed on that kind of timescales.
Yeah, yeah.
Right,
and so there's a totally different imperative here.
Totally different imperative. And the whole world, you'd think the whole world would just cooperate together.
Largely. Largely. Most of the powerful nations would have to.
Yeah.
And would, probably.
Yeah.
They'd band together for very... They do that, you know, for scientific research now. So the chances that, you know, in order to save the whole of humanity and, like, the leaders themselves are thinking about saving themselves, etc., etc.
Yeah.
Everything leads to...
There's, like, a definite personal risk to everybody.
Yes.
Right? So, like, even the most powerful people who are insulated from all the current world problems...
Yes.
...are going to be like, shit, I'm going to die.
Yeah.
So everyone's going to have a really, really good reason to be sorting it out.
Yeah.
And, I mean, they're just... All of the resources is just going to get piled into it, surely. Like,
yeah.
Everything else is just going to be insignificant in terms of importance.
Yes.
Compared to, like, saving as many people as
but
possible.
But in that period of time... So we're thinking about how we would do it and where would we go.
Yeah.
You say, like, we'd pile resources into trying to create something in which we would... So considering a scenario where the solar system isn't screwed or the solar system is screwed.
Sure.
One of which we would do the, I guess the obvious thing is to try and move to like Mars or something.
That's probably it.
And that would, you know, obviously require lots of effort. And we'll talk about the moral issues in a bit, but obviously you might not be able to move everyone, you might be able to move a lot of people or whatever.
I mean, moving everybody is going to be essentially impossible, I think.
Probably. And people won't want to leave, of course.
Yeah, of course. The people who would choose to stay, for sure, even though they're doomed like to a fiery death or whatever it is, what scenario
sure.
is going to be.
Yeah.
So how many people we could take is going to be massively dependent on how much warning we have, probably. So if we have like something like 10 to 20 years or 50 years or less warning.
It's also dependent on whether the solar system's screwed.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
So if the solar system's screwed and we've got that period of time...
You could start ferrying people to Mars...
If the solar system's not screwed, yeah.
Sorry,
start,
if the solar system's
you
not
could
screwed,
get start,
yeah.
You could start, like, seriously considering setting up a colony on Mars and getting a good number of people in order to save, like, the human race, essentially.
Mm.
And send them with, like, loads of genetic diversity, like embryos to transplant and things. So you don't have, like, your, you know, inbreeding problem and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But
it would be, like, you know, like Elon Musk's vision of having, like, a city of a million people or whatever on Mars. We would have to make that happen.
Yeah.
Like, as soon as possible.
Yes.
Everything would
This is assuming that whatever the Earth ends up being is going to be way worse than what we end up going to on Mars.
Yeah, and that would have to be really bad because Mars is not a fun place to live.
Yeah. As we said, there's not many scenarios, but sure. Considering it under that tent pretense. But say
the solar system is screwed.
Yeah.
And we can't, like, going to Mars is just not an option because we'd be just as fucked. Like, what would we do? Like,
well, let's say we've got 50 years, okay?
Yeah.
Scary
thought,
years,
isn't it? Imagine that. Imagine just like how. It
well, actually, just thinking in the quick scenario, the Earth screwed, whatever. There is like we might send off something like you said earlier about sending like just some embryos out or something like that, like a life raft. Just like, is there any way we can preserve anything we've ever done, or I know, and make all that time and effort and evolution and lives and etc. not meaningless? Is there any last little the last grasp attempt at just making that
just keeping
mean
it going.
Something potentially.
It's sort of like the Noah situation. You build an ark and you put into it as much of the biosphere as you can. Well, like
no, I'm talking
stuff.
About I'm talking about when you've got no lead time and you've just got like a conventional, you know, you've got a lead time of like 3 months, like or whatever.
Yeah, okay, but
you can't save anyone is what I'm saying, but you can just
okay.
So you just put out like some.
You just put out a probe with
probe
some
either information
embryos
on
and
it
some
or
seeds
some,
maybe and stuff like that.
Mm. Like a time.
I mean,
capsule.
that's almost a grasp at nothing, really.
Yeah, but do you think people would do that?
I don't know.
Do you think we're too busy to set, sort of just thinking, shit, we've got to save ourselves, but we might not, you know, probably wouldn't be able to in whatever scenario this is.
I think there would be a push to do that.
From
I do.
Some people.
Yeah, I think it might happen because you could.
You've got to organise a launch and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, but there's plenty of launches organised all the time. And
you just, like, scrap the satellites.
Yeah,
exactly.
You convert something that was originally going to be some mission to the outer solar system or something into that probe.
And you just...
Quickly.
Yeah.
And you just rush it and you launch it as you would normally.
Well, you've got that whole problem of, like, do you just launch it out of the solar system? Do you just launch it? You've got to launch it somewhere. You don't want to launch it around an orbit in which it's going to degrade and then just, like, crash into Jupiter.
No, it would have to have enough velocity to get out of the solar system.
Yeah,
it would have to. Otherwise, what's the point?
Yeah,
if the solar system's screwed,
you might. So, in short periods of time, it might be very difficult to redesign something to do that. Maybe.
Yeah,
maybe not. Anyway, say you've got enough time to do that. Then perhaps they say a year or something.
Yeah.
Then maybe you'd be able to do that.
But if you had 50 years, you could plausibly build a spacecraft that had a living crew, but also like a shitload of embryos and a shitload of like seeds and, you know, whatever, like aspects of the biosphere you would want to try and just like a giant like floating like archive of the Earth.
Yes.
With also like
some people
and massive amounts of information.
So this is 50 years,
scientific information.
This is 50 years assuming that the solar system's messed up.
Yeah. Is that a better... Yeah. So what's a more important endeavor, like trying to rescue as many people as possible or trying to like secure the survival of the of humanity and the biosphere as efficiently as possible? Those two things might not be the same thing. Because building a ship that keeps a few people alive.
Are we getting into the moral issues?
Maybe, but maybe not. No, not so much. No, it's still like a functionally how you go about doing it.
Yeah, because you've got to put your effort into one of the things, but that's a choice. That's like a moral dilemma.
Yeah, sure. It is, yeah.
To be honest, it probably wouldn't be that different, because you're probably going to send, say you send X number of people.
Yeah.
Like, to send also some like frozen seeds and frozen whatevers, it's just going to be like cargo, essentially. Like, it's maybe not going to be...
Yeah, that's true.
...that difficult.
That's true, but it's a lot
embryos
easier.
Embryos you need to do anyway to for people. It would be... Yeah, it's extra effort. But the thing is, like, most of humanity's not going on this thing, so all of everyone's effort can be put into it.
Yeah.
It's upmass that you've got to...
Yeah.
You're sacrificing, basically.
Yeah.
But you've got to sacrifice a lot of that in terms of consumables. You want to probably grow stuff on board and whatnot anyway. So you're going to have to take some of the biosphere anyway in that sense. Taking, like, you know, like... X number of like 1,000 seeds or something from different plants around the world, 1,000 embryos from different animals around the world is going to take up not that much space.
That's true. But taking a lot of people will take up a lot of space, and it might be that we just decide that we can't do that and we should focus on a small crew.
Yes.
And as much of this other stuff as possible.
Yeah. And that's their burden. They just have to go.
Yeah.
Out
knowing, that's it.
Knowing that they're
everybody
leaving.
Else is going to die.
Yeah.
That's which we'll come back to.
And so how would we do that? Is like. We've got, say, 50 years. But things like, you know, crazy ideas that you sort of seem crazy, but we think about Project Orion coming back on. It's just like, screw the atmosphere. Screw, you know, like, it doesn't matter if we nuke and irradiate everything. This is the quickest, most efficient way to get ourselves
to
out
get
of
a large
velocity.
Amount of mass up.
Yeah. And where would they go as well, is another question. We have, you know, 50 years to be trying to find a place in which, in the solar system, in which they could go to.
In the solar system, if the whole
solar system, outside the solar system, an exoplanet.
Yeah, and there's sort of two. I think there's two scenarios. Either, yeah, but you have find somewhere, which is possibly not going to happen in 50 years. You might not have. Actually, having said that, there would likely be like a prime, like a first choice location to aim for. I would have thought so. You out of the whole suite of like Kepler data exoplanets, you just choose the one that looks the most like Earth and just go there, maybe aim towards it.
You probably would. Yeah.
Better than just literally going off and
going
shooting
nowhere.
In the dark.
Exactly. So you'd pick whatever data you've got on exoplanets at the moment, the most likely habitable planet that you could potentially, you know. And you would know things about like its size and stuff and estimates on its atmosphere. In 50 years' time, you'd spend a lot of effort trying to build something that would be able to kind of define those things in exoplanets of a certain distance and size. So you would be able to do things like try and calculate how you might re-enter into its atmosphere and stuff.
Yeah. But these kind of
and
things...
You might, I mean, James Webb's launching whatever time. Chances are we might know its composition of its atmosphere somewhat.
That's true.
And things. So we might understand that there is... You'd definitely aim for like an exoplanet in that situation. You had 50 years... And you had one like crew. You'd just go to somewhere. This is our best chance. This is the best thing we know about. Let's just fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, you just or the other option is you try and build something that it survives indefinitely in interstellar space. But then that might be not possible in 50 years' time. With 50 years of technology development.
Yeah, that's true.
And the motive behind that as well is like trying to save the human species, not trying to save your own skin in a way. So that the development speed might not be as fast, because it's kind of like an altruistic thing that we'd be like, we're gonna die, we're sacrificing ourselves, but we need to like get this like memory of us out. Maybe, I don't know, I'm not quite sure how people's motivations would work for that. I feel like it would be generally quite good, but it might not be as fast as you would think. You might not be able to build so much crazy stuff in 50 years as you might expect with that, under that pretense, because people would be distracted by,
yeah, that's very true,
by trying to get their everything in order. And
yeah,
like,
and maybe people living people would place more importance on saving their own lives over,
yeah,
like trying to come up, survival of humanity,
trying to come up with a way, even if it was like under a scenario in which we probably know it's highly impossible that we're going to survive it at all, coming up for of a way of like trying to save themselves. Like, if the whole of the Earth's going to be destroyed or whatever, like a neutron star's coming in or whatever, and it's going to just ruin the whole solar system,
yeah,
that they can like live underground or whatever, even under the pretense, just even though that's never going to work,
yeah,
and we know that the Earth's going to be slung off,
there'll be plenty
into
of people
like the
think...
depths of, you know, the Oort cloud or whatever, then there'll be plenty of people still trying to think of a way like how we could potentially sort ourselves,
yeah,
out.
And probably a massive contingent of people will place their bets on that method,
yeah,
rather than decide to get in a ship going to God knows where.
Yeah, I just mean that the focus of governments and big projects might be to try and like run the Earth under a scenario in which it's impossible. We think it's probably impossible, and it ends up being impossible to survive.
Yeah,
but under the hope that we'll find like a solution.
Yeah,
before it's too late, mm-hmm. rather than like just accepting that we're going to die and putting all our effort into getting something to continue what we've done.
Yeah,
small way.
Yeah, I mean, facing that,
maybe both
facing
would be
that
impossible.
Reality is a pretty sort of dark prospect for
yeah.
for everyone alive now.
In so, that quickly in that tangent, if the Earth got slung off,
yeah,
to like Pluto type orbits,
yeah.
Would if at a certain point in our technological development we would probably not would we be able to survive that, possibly?
Yeah, we probably would.
we're under the pretense that it's recognizable, kind of, well, it's still recognizable that we might be able to survive that.
Yeah, I mean, in the same way that we discuss going and colonizing various planets that yeah. have conditions like icy moons or like Mars
yeah.
or something, then why would we not be able to just use that same technology and those same designs to just survive on Earth?
Yeah, okay, so yeah, but then again, so we can consider another scenario then where there's just like, it's going to be like the late heavy bombardment or something. The Earth's just going to get like
just smashed
yeah. to pieces by loads
yeah.
of stuff,
which plausibly could happen if the solar system
and people might think
perturbed.
We could maybe make like deep bomb shelters or things, but
yeah.
chances are it's going to get like,
or even we're just going to fall into the sun,
yes, or something
or
like
something
that.
Just ridiculous,
yeah. or the
like
sucked into the neutron star or
yeah.
whatever.
Yeah, I mean, there's no getting away from that.
No.
So that yeah, so that's yeah, we would definitely yes. So under that scenario, governments wouldn't even have the option of trying to hunker down and build
yeah.
a, I don't know, like a base underground or something. Yeah. They'd have to think, they'd either have to be like, okay, so do we try and save as many people as possible, or do we try and secure like survival of the human species and the biosphere?
Yeah.
Those two things possibly aren't like either
mutually
or
exclusive.
Yeah.
No. But so yeah, so that would I think that's kind of, under the scenario there, you would just try and send something to an exoplanet with some people on it.
Yeah.
And hope and have some, either try and go to the, have, you know, the kind of put people in kind of cryogenic states or whatever to then reawaken, or
have a multi-generational ship.
Or, yes, because it's going to take a long time.
Well, I mean,
we're talking about 50 years. So chances are we're not.
Conventional technology
is going to be.
Some of that like Project Orion stuff. Or no, the Daedalus thing could get pretty significantly close to the speed of light,
yeah,
right? It was like 90-something percent, wasn't it? Was that
no,
right?
No, that's the antimatter
else.
One.
Oh, yeah, okay. Which is, that's sci-fi.
But say like 12% speed of light, which is possibly things like Orion and stuff could do.
Yeah, still going to need multi-generational stuff. Oh, wait, no, because of time
remember.
Dilation.
Yeah, but 12% at 12%
yeah.
speed of light. I don't
it's
know exactly what the point of the... I don't know how that curve works.
Yeah, sure.
But
you don't know what you're going to find when you get there, which is the most important thing. So
yeah.
you're going to need this, whatever it is, this ship, to be capable of support, of just being indefinitely support life, support humans. It can't have like a shelf life.
Is it possible to... Yeah, I guess you'd have to just put your effort into that, into building something that is self-sufficient and has enough materials
yeah.
on it to repair and sort itself out and
is
whatever.
Is that doable in 50 years?
Maybe not. Maybe it would need 100 years
you
or something.
You just need to be recycling everything, all the gases and atmospheres, all the waste products need to be recycled back into like food, and you know, you need to be... The whole thing has to be perfect, basically. The way it functions, the way it recycles
yeah.
stuff.
Although
you can't have any like finite resource that you're worried about running out of.
Yeah, that you've got to regenerate everything.
Yeah.
It's almost like everything's got to come from... It's almost like electricity. Because you could solar panels for indefinitely, potentially.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because solar panels
yeah.
don't break.
Maybe, yeah.
Or a reactor that lasts like 1,000 years or something. Like a specific type of nuclear reactor.
Maybe you'd use...
like a fusion or something.
You could use like a finite resource like fuel propellant to get yourself up to speed. You obviously need the equivalent amount to slow yourself down again, though. That's the problem. Yeah. So you'd always have to be like working on a rule of halves with that. But everything else, you'd need to just be a closed loop to have everything being recycled. Because you never know if you're going to ever make it somewhere else. You're always forever trapped inside this craft.
So maybe there's no hope in those scenarios particularly. But you would still try and do something. So like what if we have a very long lead time?
Okay. So the event, whatever it's gonna be, is gonna happen in like a lot, like 1,000 years
or 100,000 years.
Or even 100,000 years.
Whatever, yeah.
A crazy amount of time.
Then we've got, obviously we can only talk about this in terms of, we don't know what technology is going to happen,
yeah,
and singularity and all this kind of whatever stuff that we can speculate on, but
yeah, it gets quite hard to, like, your imagination is just sort of like the only
almost
limit
the limit, yeah. But there's still like some considerations you would need to make in terms of where you would go and stuff like that.
Sure.
So if we had a very long time, we would be able to move a lot more of the human population.
Definitely,
off
yes.
The Earth. What you're trying to do, I guess, would be to construct like some sort of humongous structure.
Yeah, like a giant, almost like a habitat kind of thing. Like capable of supporting. I mean, I guess the ultimate goal is to try and take as many people as you possibly can. You don't want to have to leave people to die. So, like, that is the ultimate goal. Whether that's ever going
to
be possible, I don't know. Like,
to
billions upon billions of people.
10, 20, however many.
However many is going to be.
100,000 years. The human population will. It's increasing, but it will tail off at some point.
Yeah,
probably.
It will. But if we've expanded into the solar system, you know, the population, who knows what population.
Well, this is the thing. It depends. Again, we've got those two scenarios. So we've got a very long lead time, but it's only going to destroy Earth. Then we obviously just move everyone to Mars.
Yes, yeah. And scatter throughout the solar system.
And scatter wherever we can. But in the scenario where it's going to destroy the whole solar system, then we have to think seriously about creating, like, like a giant, like, orbital habitat that orbits something or
is capable of traveling, yeah, itself, yeah.
A long way away.
And it just essentially becomes our home for however long it takes to get to wherever we're going.
Yeah.
And you could possibly even, I mean, with that amount of time, you could possibly even build a fleet of these things.
Yeah.
Each one with like 10 million people. I mean, that's a ridiculous number. I mean, I'm thinking of a huge, huge, huge thing. What I'm imagining is like a cylindrical habitat.
Yeah.
The inner surface of which is like, I don't know, like just a normal, like,
well,
forests,
like,
and lakes. I don't know.
Again, I'm thinking that
it's all science fiction.
Mass Effect Citadel with this like big arms that like rotate.
Okay.
And they've got like, you know, different like habitats. It's like a big circle kind of.
Yeah,
thing.
But that kind of thing. I mean, that's the way of you know, maximizing like your area to take in most people and having essentially like you've got artificial gravity and everything.
Yeah.
And it just becomes like a bit of a home.
And you'd have to construct that with, you know, what we were talking about last week, some of the like space elevator things, kind of getting all this stuff up. You'd have to build like whole systems, new systems, in order to start getting the stuff in orbit.
Yeah. But with that amount of time, obviously technology is going to continue to develop massively. We're going to be pushing more and more resources into doing it because we know that brick wall is coming.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
it's going to be, if not like the most significant focus now, it will become more and more like the thing that everyone's working on.
If we're constructing something that massive in like Earth's orbit,
yeah,
we're going to have to like clear out like the whole of the orbital debris in that like
part.
It's going to spend ages kind of like preparing space to take to begin construction of something so large.
Yeah. You might not even do it in Earth's orbit. You might do it in like the Lagrange point of the Earth and the Sun. So it's like trailing behind the Earth somewhere. And use like the asteroid belt as your like raw materials of like building these giant things.
Or around the moon or something like that.
Yeah. Just gradually start ferrying people to them.
Yeah. Crazy.
Yeah, it's a really crazy thing. You'd also have a lot more time to pick a destination as well.
Yeah.
So we were talking about like using like the Jimmy Webb or something to try and find an exoplanet, or even just like existing Kepler data if it was a short term thing. But with this, we would be able to, like, with that, you'd just be picking the best of a bad scenario. You'd be like, oh, okay, that planet looks like the most like Earth, even though it doesn't look anything like Earth, let's go there. But with this, like, we potentially have enough time to really scour the Milky Way, or at least our local area, and find something that is a very good candidate.
Yeah. Exactly. You'd spend a long time and a lot of resources trying to find what is the potential, you know, best scenario we have.
Yeah, you might find the planet with life on. I mean,
yeah, that has like a really obvious like red edge, like
exactly. Kind of, like, okay, there's oxygen in the atmosphere there. Like, that planet has a biosphere. We might even be able to breathe the air. I mean, this is a ridiculous thing. But then, you know,
is that a bad idea, though?
Yeah, I don't know. Well, what if we've detected, like, an alien civilization?
Yeah.
Not just a biosphere, but, like, a civilization
there.
Like
a signal coming from a galaxy or something.
Because with 100,000 years, that's just a much bigger time of a sampling time. So, like, statistically, we're more likely to have come across something, whether it's just like detecting an Earth-like planet or even detecting in a civilization.
Yeah. And then those are the scenarios that it's like, is that a good idea to try and turn up and be like a refugee kind of?
Yeah.
Like we'd be like in District 9. You know, where they come and they've got like a battered old ship.
Yeah. We would be the prawns. Which didn't work out too well for them. But at least they survived. At least they were alive.
Yeah.
You know, could have been worse. Yeah. For them, possibly.
Possibly.
So if you get a signal, maybe that is the best place to aim for, at least in terms of it's a habitable planet.
You just got to hope that whoever's there.
Well, there's only habitable. You don't. It's tricky because you might find that you get a signal and you look at the planet in more detail and it's not very habitable for us. So maybe we wouldn't head for it.
Possibly. It depends how much information you've got that's been conveyed to you by these signals.
Yeah.
So if you've got like a particular like race that you think is based on like similar biology or whatever, then you might aim for that. If it sounds like they breed like sulfur and all these kinds of things, then you might be like, that's not the best place to go to.
They still might have resources.
But they might have energy and stuff
able
they
to
can
help you. Yeah.
If you could communicate like a distress signal, but they might obviously there's like they might be suspicious of that. Mm.
Think of you as like an invading force or something.
Yeah.
And even if we're not, and we might be more to talk about that later. But even if we're not, and we're just there like, oh, help us, they might be like just super defensive and not want us anywhere near them.
I mean we're putting obviously like a human kind of society kind of view on this. I have no idea what we'll be coming across, but a bit like this kind of refugee thing that's happening now, some people are like well up for letting lots of people in, some people are, you know, very much against it. Perhaps you'd have both.
I wonder what would happen if you have, so you're building this fleet of all these things and you've detected a civilization and you know that planet is likely habitable, but you've also made a detection of an Earth-like planet that you also think is very likely habitable, but there's no evidence for a civilization. Which one would you go for?
Depends how, if you've been able to communicate with them and it's friendly and it feels like it's a good idea to try that, then you go.
Yeah, but let's say you haven't. Let's say the time it would take to communicate is too long. And you need to make that decision. Do you go? Is it a safer bet to go for the planet where there's no civilization? What possibly is?
There's a time dilation thing again. If it's depending on how far away the two are.
Yeah.
If we consider them equal distance, and it's going to take, I don't know, 1,000 years to get there or something. Obviously, we don't know what like state that civilization is going to be in when we get there.
Yeah, sure.
And we don't know what state that planet's going to be in when we get there. So it's a risk either way.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No, I don't know.
It does depend.
I feel like if you haven't been able to communicate, it's just too much of a risk to head directly towards an unknown civilization.
Yeah, maybe it's better to go for like a blank canvas kind of thing.
You still know they're there, so that's cool. We still have contact. You know, we can send a message or something.
Yeah, maybe. Asking them, like saying like, we're in distress or whatever, please help us.
But if we start on our journey there, and then it's like shit, you know, in 1,000 years or whatever, we're just going to turn up on their doorstep.
And then they go, no.
Yeah, get out. Yeah. That might not be the best idea.
No, but, it might not be. So like in the very far future, if you have things like AIs and whatnot, you might, your technology curve might be so different that you don't worry about kind of moving anyone. You just let the AI decide. You just kind of,
well, yeah, that's
it's
true.
Not a problem. In fact, you might get to a point with like singularity stuff where you don't, there's like an existential risk, but you don't even know about it.
Yeah.
Like you're just sort of like in a virtual world, just living up your life, and the AI is just
everything.
Like, I'll sort it out. Or yeah. whatever. And it just sort of
just like moves deflects
things.
That neutron star.
Or, does, yeah,
or
does
even, whatever. Yeah, just moves the human race without them even knowing they've been moved. I mean, yeah, it gets a little bit silly and hard to imagine exactly what's going to happen. But yeah, I mean, in the very, very far future, even 100,000 years is a hell of a long time.
I mean, can you imagine 100,000 years? I think mean, how much things change in like
the
50
concept,
years.
The concept of like disasters that like can damage planets and things like that being a threat to us in 100,000 years it's might just be laughable.
Yeah,
might
potentially.
Like, why were we ever worried about that?
Yeah.
Like, it's fine.
Yeah, who knows?
We just restructure the solar system, you know, build something. I don't know. Who knows? It could be crazy. But say the singularity hasn't happened, or if it has, like, it's not quite as impactful as possibly we think it might be. Maybe it's an idea as well as like building a fleet of these giant stations to send giant like habitat ships to send humans out. You'd also kind of start sending AI craft everywhere. So you aim for your planet that you think is a good idea to aim for, but you also kind of scatter
probes
throughout the galaxy, and they gradually start exploring. And they could be, you know, these people talk about these like self-replicating probes that arrive in a system and then build another copy themselves and send them off in two different directions. And you just do that every time, and you gradually start building out like a map of the galaxy, bit by bit. So even if you arrive at your system with all your humanity, like thousands, millions of people, and find that it's shit, then you've got possible other options.
This party's dead.
Yeah, you're kind of like building up that map in the same way you know you do in like a strategy game when you first start, and you start kind of like blocking out the map.
Yeah,
your probes are sort of doing that for you as your arcs, for want of a better word, are like traveling across the galaxy.
Yeah, possibly. Although, again, it depends on how we're assuming. I guess at this point that you've got your arc is like self-preserving, like it's.
Yeah, well, I think with this kind of amount of time, we would be essentially making. It's not really a ship we're building. It's almost like a home,
like an
artificial planet almost. Yes, I mean, I don't literally mean like a sphere, but something that we could live
a Death
on.
Star.
Oh yeah.
In that period of time, the AI could build a Death Star and then just like destroy the neutron star or whatever.
Definitely,
I don't know.
Definitely build a Death Star.
But yes, we could build like a planet-sized kind of
not planet-sized. Sorry, I didn't really mean like an artificial planet in that sense.
No.
But just like what I'm imagining is a
self-contained,
totally
like
self-contained habitat that's absolutely
colossal,
huge, and possibly has even like landscape and stuff in it.
Yeah,
I mean,
like
so
multiple city-sized kind of. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
Big thing.
Big enough to have civilization contained in it.
Yeah.
I wonder if you get, like, if you did have a fleet of these things, and they're all traveling to the same place, but they're, you know, obviously be separated by space, whether, you know, each of them kind of develop their own little cultures and stuff.
Probably.
And
if you didn't have much, well, you'd have
transfer between them, yeah.
There'd probably be, like, real efforts and, like, dedicated things to make sure that they don't try and split off in certain ways or become, like, rogue or decide on this.
Just become rogue. One of them's like, oh, we're not going to follow you guys. We're going to go to this other place.
Yeah, there's, like, there's not a consensus on where you're going anymore.
Yeah.
And so this kind of fleet begins to split off and people are taking their own kind of, like, ideas and views about it.
And then humanity sort of seeded itself into multiple new locations, which is a weird thought.
Huh.
Cool thought.
Yeah.
And you could end up quite disconnected, as in could be so far away from each other eventually that these like the ultimate kind of end goals of these ships could end up so far away from each other that communication is like not really feasible and stuff, and it's just it's just become totally different civilizations.
Yeah. Who knows?
I know.
Yeah. Crazy. That's when you think about the far future stuff, it is just like totally.
I know, yeah. It does start to become quite difficult to rein in your kind of imagination.
Yeah.
But there's lots of possible directions.
If we think about some of the moral and like kind of social issues that could come up from, well, I guess we have to think about this in near and term and like future kind of context.
Yeah, again, the far future stuff gets quite hard to imagine.
Yes, but yes, yeah, okay. So let's more discuss first about like a recognizable society.
Yeah, sure.
So
it's
if
like, what if this happened now-ish, basically?
Now-ish, yeah, even like within advanced technology. Or in like, you know, 100 years, whatever.
Yeah.
We aren't probably going to be able to get everyone off Earth.
No.
So the first questions are, is like, who runs this thing?
Yeah.
Who's in charge of, I mean, maybe every nation has its own kind of program.
Yeah, but then surely you still need someone to kind of spearhead it. If each nation, or do you mean, literally mean each nation is building their own ship or something like that?
Maybe.
There's plenty of nations that won't be able to do that.
Exactly. Exactly.
I mean, I feel like, if it was an immediate threat, like going back to what we were talking about before about it being like 50 years or less away, like the event, I feel like you would get global, at least global collaboration on a single project.
Quite possibly, but do you think, so obviously like the support for, in certain countries, so say, like maybe within Europe or say America, they said like, the American money that goes into this, we want it to go into saving Americans or saving Europeans or saving British people or whatever, you know.
Like, yeah.
Are the countries going to pretend, think in that sort of selfish way? Or are they going to be like, where everyone's going to put their resources into saving as many people from as many countries as possible?
It's possibly the former. Well, you might think that, okay, we've paid X amount of money. That means we get that proportion of people on this ship have to be from our country. You know, you buy tickets, essentially.
Yeah,
that's what you're doing. Although, so that is either that way of looking at it, or
there's not like there might not be a monetary value as such anymore, though.
Sure, like, yeah.
If you see what I mean, if there's no,
well,
there
resources
no...
are still going to be important, aren't they? Because the country with the most resources is going to be the one that does probably the most building of whatever this thing is.
Yes.
So maybe they will view that as a, you know, they've sort of bought their right to have the majority of number of people on board.
Yeah.
Or the other way of looking at it is that it will be more rationalised than that, and that we'll realise that what we need really is a diverse range of people.
Yeah.
To like maximise genetic diversity and stuff like that.
So if you think about a small crew,
mm-hmm.
this like life raft of people that get sent out, under the scenario that we've not got very long and we just have to send like people some seeds, you know, embryos, that sort of scenario. In that case, you're not going to be sending out people who are not highly... You're basically going to be sending out astronauts. Like highly trained, extremely, like, high capability.
Educated.
Very well educated, etc., etc. people.
Yeah.
And that's people of those type only come from certain countries. There are very few people that come from poorer third world countries that are astronauts because they don't have the access to those kinds of, you know, education systems, etc., etc.
Yeah.
So your crew for this like small thing could be like racially diverse, but it's not going to be that diverse in terms of coming from a few nations.
Yeah.
But like, there's loads of third world countries that would not be getting anyone on that thing.
Yeah. Sure. Even if it's quite a large crew, I mean, it wouldn't have to be. I mean, are you talking about just like maybe 5 to 10 people? Or are you talking about like,
or even 100?
100, yeah. Even 100, yeah. Agreed. They would still be 100 of like probably
you need every
the
experts
most highly
in every
skilled
area.
Experts of exactly, like really real experts in various science and engineering fields, medicine, and all that kind of stuff.
Exactly, yeah.
As well as like the technical expertise to run the ship,
how to grow food there, like botanists, like, you know, engineers to run like the solar panels, all those kinds of things. It would just be like a highly trained like unit of very specialised and extremely smart and you know, highly capable people.
So there's going to be huge like whole demographics and whole populations of countries that just don't even get a look in,
and
like, that just have no,
and that's, although that's probably, I mean, you could argue people could train people to do that, maybe that's true, in the time we're talking about small amounts of time,
yeah, and that's a way that, I mean, that would be viewed as a waste of resources doing that, seeing as we already have the pool of expertise ready to go.
It might be, but obviously it's not, I don't know, it might not be seen as a waste of resources for people just because it's like we're trying to get like representatives of everyone out there.
The other thing
is you need a cohesive crew that understand each other and that are culturally similar in a way, so there's not like a big cult like tensions within the group. You know, it would probably be an unfortunate, like, very objective, we have to have this succeed, that's the only thing we're selecting this on.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at the facts and figures and saying this is the best, these people are going to make this the most likely way it's going to succeed. And if that means it's just a crew from the US or just a crew from wherever, then that's just, sorry, tough shit. Like, we're trying to save the species, and that's our best chance of doing
it.
Our best way to mitigate existential risk is unfortunately to have to do that.
To send the most skilled people. Yeah.
But
even, so if it's like you are capable of sending thousands or even millions of people, it gets slightly different because now you won't just be sending absolute top of the field experts and everything. You will so be sending a cross section.
What numbers are we talking?
Okay, let's go ridiculous and say
yeah.
1 to 10 million.
Nice.
I mean, it's a lot of people.
Yeah.
And maybe this is more of like a far future like scenario that we have time to build like a giant habitat type thing.
Yeah.
Let's say like 1 to 10 million people. So now you are sending a cross section of society because 10 million people aren't going to be all experts. You're going to have all people from all walks of life going on this thing now.
Yeah.
So how do you select these people? Because it's still only a tiny fraction of the population of the Earth, of course. So like, how do you select? Is it literally just a lottery? You have your like, the experts you need, and they're picked, selected properly.
Yes, but the rest you have of to have people, to run the ship, and like, yeah, is like,
is that a necessity?
You know, you should run just like anything basic, like a cruise ship or something.
Yeah,
you know, you have to have people highly trained to run the ship in a certain way.
The rest of the population is almost just there to provide a pool of genetic diversity, really.
Yeah, and just like a big sample of humanity.
You
know, we're just trying to save lives essentially in that scenario. And then again, it's like that thing, like, if someone's putting more resources than everyone else, their population's going to be going. If there's like a lottery for people to get in, people want more of a chance to save them and their families or whatever.
Yeah.
And so they want, say it's a 1 in 50 chance they're going to get on it or something. But if they've put in like 50 or 60% of the resources, they might say, no, we want it as a 1 in 10 chance because we've put in that appropriate amount of expertise and skill and stuff to do it.
And there might be also an argument to adjust it by population.
And those are arguments that I'm not saying. I'm just saying that's what a population might think.
Of course. Yeah. Which is sort of all the stuff we're discussing in this section is like rationalized rather than like our actual views of how it should be done.
Yeah, which is difficult.
Which is very difficult, yeah. So you might even find that it gets adjusted by population. So like countries, you know, you have the proportional representation of people on that ship is proportional to how much population you have. I mean, maybe that's a slightly less biased way of doing it than just resource allocation, like which countries put in the most resources.
Yeah, but it's they can. That's
because
like,
then you get a more representative snapshot of what the Earth looks like in terms of people, numbers of people.
You do, but you might not want like a representative snapshot.
Yeah, that's true.
It might be
that's
like because it'll be dominated by like smaller, like say, they're still quite genetically diverse, but like like China and India would have a lot more people.
They would,
than a lot of Western countries, which is not necessarily a bad thing. But you would want, you might think, perhaps we want like kind of more of an even division of different races to again for genetic diversity.
Yeah, true.
So you might want like, you know, X number of a particular race, X number of to kind of like portion it out in a more kind of, rather than like a sort of politicized country like divisions of your
you divide it in like genetic
like,
diversity
and get your best like snapshot of everyone.
Yeah,
and then you say, you've got like, say, you want, I don't know, 1/8 of them, you want them to be Chinese, or like a particular race within like Asia or something like that. And then the countries that have like that particular race within them, you then like take out like portions of each of that like eighth from different countries in order to get a wider snapshot of the different like cultures within that thing or whatever.
Yeah, but I think you're right. Genetic diversity is probably going to be the overriding, like, driving requirement for getting a spread of people
probably
on board.
Yeah, that's tricky. That's tricky to select.
It's very tricky, and it will ultimately be a lottery within those constraints. It will be a lottery, probably.
Probably, yeah. Although you'd probably have people with like. You wouldn't take people probably. Would you take people from like prisons and stuff? You just say you're going to die, unfortunately.
Yeah. Oh, I don't
know. Like criminal convictions. Do you have like any filters, or do you just go pure luck or what?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, that's a really hard question to answer. Thinking
waters.
Yeah, it's very murky waters. And again, this isn't like what I think should happen particularly.
True.
But I feel like under those circumstances, maybe we would just leave prisoners to die.
And for, possibly on the basis that there will still be crime and stuff on these like giant.
There absolutely will be.
But you want to minimise the risk of that.
Yes,
it's like
exactly.
Again, cutting down existential risk.
If you take a proportion of people from prisons on board, and you know that that's increasing in whatever small fraction, that's going to increase your risk of like crime, violence, whatever on board this thing, then surely that's enough of a reason to not do it.
Yeah, which is also obviously in a way it's tragic because, well, yeah, some people in prisons obviously have just had some bad luck. Whatever.
Yeah, exactly. But it's a whole thing is just driven by statistics, basically, like a statistical increase in chance of bad things happening on board.
And yeah, you'd just be like...
Tragic is definitely the right word.
Yeah, the whole thing is tragic.
Yeah, for sure.
Definitely tragic. Actually, really quite horrible to think about.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
It's kind of... Because, well, this is quite a fun topic, but in a way, it's not that fun.
No, I mean, the reality of this would be, like, horrendous.
Yeah.
Because you imagine after that lottery's happened, like, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Like, suddenly...
And then, like, someone gets, like, a ticket. Like, but you've only got... And you've got a ticket, say we all entered, like, we've got one ticket, and only in our family only one person got a ticket or something like that, and so only one person brought. That's another thing. Do you say you take a whole family, so a ticket represents like a family, or do you take do you leave behind people without families? Do you take people who've never had families on purpose?
Yeah.
Do you want to take everyone's loved ones, in the sense that the people who go aboard don't want to be like depressed and,
yeah, you and make and, sure the psychological like health of the crew is
high.
Is high, yeah.
Exactly. You don't really want to be just taking like the odd person from other families and then just sort of like chucking them all together, because the chances
of
that...
You might have a shit time.
The whole thing, but again, you're increasing your risk of things
exactly.
going wrong.
Yeah.
Of, like you say, the psychological health degrading much faster. So you'd want people to be happy. So you don't really want in any way to have those just one ticket and people trying to decide. You need to kind of like select, or maybe not select... In a way, there probably is some randomness. You select down to certain groups and then select random families or like households or whatever.
Yeah.
But it would have to be more careful than just a basic lottery.
I would think. Yeah, you're right. It would have to be. It's more complex than that.
Yeah.
And you know, the people in charge of it have a huge amount of responsibility.
You would
on
have
their shoulders.
That you would, but you'd have like. Like you do with understanding how to like select like landing sites for like Mars. There's like loads of different opinions about it, but eventually you end up with a consensus that's argued and argued and argued.
Yeah.
And some people won't quite agree with like some parts of it, but you have to end up with something.
Yeah, eventually you
There'll
end
be
up
a
with
system
the average
devised.
Best
yeah,
opinion.
like a system that we devise for like running democracies or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
You never get it quite right, but you kind of do.
Yeah,
the
you're
best.
Never going to please
think,
everybody.
Yeah.
Obviously not with something like this.
No.
But the people left behind, like. I mean, even before this thing is left, but once the lottery's done and we know who's on the crew and who's not, you know, there's going to be millions, billions of people that know they're just doomed to die.
Yeah.
And regardless of whether that's like spread unfairly or seemingly unfairly from different demographic groups or different countries or something, you're going to have probably uprisings. People, the world's going to start falling apart, I would imagine. People are going to be desperate. They're going to be absolutely desperate. They're even if it's impossible, they're going to think that there's somehow they're going to be able to get themselves on that ship. So they're going to bands of people will probably start fighting for that. Or I mean, I don't.
That's
it's really
true.
Hard
you
to
can
predict.
Have a whole war.
Yeah, but... like uprisings of people, like revolts. And I'm not even wondering.
And
if...
you'd have a lot of kind of the population left with like plenty of capability and resources. To do some like serious kind of harm to each other or damage to the ship or
damage to the I mean, it might even get to that. People are crazy, you know. People
will be driven crazy.
So that I'm even thinking if
although they might just put those efforts instead of fighting into try and build their own kind
that's
of
true.
Types of things.
That's true.
To escape. Maybe that would probably be. Although, yeah, maybe I don't know. I think there probably be a mixture of the two.
Yeah, but if the whole world is pooling its resources to build this whatever it is. Then there might not be that much stuff left over to have like equivalent efforts built on the other side of the world or something like that. It's really hard to imagine exactly how it would play out.
If you're talking about like you're saying in this 1 to 10 million kind of style thing, obviously you can't. There's only you can only build that like once in the potentially in the period of time you have. I mean, maybe there's a scenario where you just assume that we're so good at that point we just get everyone off and it's just like we just spend like 1,000 years slowly taking everyone off to
these
stations, and maybe that's like the happy scenario. It's like a ridiculous technological future where that's actually not that much
apart
of a big
from
deal.
some like groups of some crazy nut people who want to just stay behind and like watch the apocalypse happen,
which will
obviously happen.
Yeah, I don't think I can do that.
Fair enough. Yeah, just take some good pictures and just start sending them up to us.
Yeah, we could leave cameras behind without them, but yeah.
But I mean, I do kind of wonder if the entity or the kind of like the global sort of combined force that's building this ship would have to be militarized and defend themselves from the rest of the population that haven't been given a ticket.
Maybe.
Just because
again another thing is if you know, if it depends where that ship's going, if you're going to find another like, if you're going towards like a distant alien signal that you think you're probably gonna, do you take guns and stuff to try and fight them off if something goes horribly wrong?
Well, that's actually a really interesting question.
Well, there's a, we just talk about Well, I mean, should we talk about that now?
Yeah, why not?
So, if we're going to,
if we have, okay, so if we have detected a signal, like an alien civilization signal, and we decide that our best shot of survival is to aim for it,
and then we get there and it's and we're not welcome, but we have no other choice but to attack them in order to basically, we basically become as like kind of like basically a hostile, like alien civilization coming to take over their planet.
Yeah, so we are the invaders. We are the invading force. We are an alien invasion, essentially. Yeah.
And we do that on the basis that, would we ever do that on the basis that we absolutely, that is our only option. Once we get there and we realise that they're not going to help us, and but we've got the capability to do some serious damage and potentially set up like a hard colony there somewhere.
Yeah.
Would we ever have the, like, would we ever want to, and morally would it be the right thing to do? Because that's the only way, our literally our only way to survive at that point.
I mean, if it comes down to the point of being, this is it, like the ships we've built or something won't last any longer, and like we absolutely have to settle here, and they won't, they're not having any of it,
yeah,
then morally, do we place us, our own importance above theirs? Probably we would, wouldn't we?
I guess so. I mean, people are desperate, they're gonna die. I mean, what, they just get desperate, they just, survival kicks in.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and so we're literally forced to aggressively take over this alien planet.
Yeah.
If we can, if we have the capability to. That's a, just sort of spins the whole, like, all the sci-fi films and books, whatever, about alien invasions. Like, yeah, you think about it from that point of view, it's like, oh, I kind of understand now.
So if you think about that as well, in terms of, we're assuming in this scenario that we're going to another star system. But, like, obviously there might be, like, Mars or something that has its own, like, political entity. Or
that's true.
Like
Yeah.
And then maybe they might decide that they don't want us as refugees, or
yeah, like suddenly like Mars, if it's like a developed world with like its own, it could be like a separate, exactly like you said, separate political entity, and suddenly it's got to deal with like an influx of literally billions of refugees from the Earth.
Yeah, although in this scenario we'd be planning ahead for it, like we're able to build these ships.
Yeah.
So we'd also, if we were going to Mars, we probably wouldn't build such large ships.
No, we wouldn't.
Be sending like stuff over there before to build the infrastructure for it.
Yeah.
If the whole solar system was going to be wiped out, then the people on, if it was a separate political entity in a city, the people on Mars would probably be wanting to get in on like helping develop these ships or having their own, or something like that.
And actually, you can imagine in a slightly less disastrous scenario, there might even be a time in the future when there is, say, a colony of civilization on Mars, but it's looking like it's better, like the quality of life on Mars is actually better than it is on the Earth. Like things are going bad on the Earth. I don't know what, really. Like climate change is out of control. Like it's just overpopulated to shit. I don't know what's happening, really. But, and that this whole situation of like refugees piling into Mars might be a lot slower, but still be something that like they have to sort of contend with.
Yeah,
an interesting like idea.
Yeah,
because suddenly like it's not just space that you're limited by; it's also like life support technology and all this kind of stuff. Gets crazy. It's a bit of a minefield.
It is a minefield. Yeah. There's a lot of kind of. Let's end this topic then on the note that potentially, the chances are this is going to probably happen it's probably not going to happen soon. Just like statistically, it's probably going to happen far in the future. Things like a neutron star coming in, AI might happen sooner rather than later, or things like the sun getting massive and screwing everything, the solar system over.
Yeah.
Those things are far in the future.
Well, we'll probably have
a huge amount of technology, and maybe at that point we'll actually be able to save a lot more people than we think we might be, than actually is possible.
Possibly even everybody, which is a crazy thought, but you never know.
Yeah. End it on a happy note. But I think, you know, we would likely to do better in the future, and
certainly
likely to have better systems to detect warnings and stuff abandon Earth. So the
statistically, it's more likely that if anything like this happens, it's not going to happen next year. It's going to happen 1,000 years from now, because of how rare these events are. However, it is definitely possible that like an asteroid impact could happen tomorrow.
Yeah.
But that like doesn't really apply. This scenario doesn't really apply because we wouldn't be able to do anything about. We wouldn't be able to leave Earth forever under those. And we just have to deal with the consequences of whatever it was that happened.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I think we've wrapped that up nicely.
Yeah.
Now it's time for Nutters of the Week.
It is time.
Da-da-da. We need a jingle.
We do. Yes, if anyone wants to make us a jingle.
Yeah, do it. Serious.
Yeah, that is serious. Even if it's rubbish, we might use it. Particularly if it's rubbish.
Yeah, it could be fun.
Yeah, as long as it's not offensive. Like highly offensive or like racist or something.
Well,
like
yeah, that. Yeah, we won't be using that. But if it's rubbish, just a bit crap, then it will definitely be earning some points. Anyway, so Nutters of the Week. This week there has been a very significant nutter.
Yeah.
Very prominent nutter. That rapper B.O.B.
Talking about, no, I heard about this.
Talking about flat Earth.
Yeah.
It's just bizarre. Like, he's obviously, it's weird because he's obviously been thinking about it loads. And yeah. Just sort of got himself into this, like, what's going on? So it's just like this whole like tirade of tweets. I mean, obviously everyone's seen this all stuff kicking off all over the news and stuff. But just tweeting about how, oh, if this has happened, surely the Earth is flat. Like, the Earth must be flat. Some of his, I've got some of them here, and only like a handful of them. I think one of the first ones was, a lot of people are turned off by the phrase flat Earth, but there's no way you can see all the evidence and not know. Grow up. This is one of the first ones. And then he started posting like this like series of photos,
right,
presumably demonstrating that the Earth
is
flat. Oh, I
did see some of them, yeah.
One of them was like him stood on like a hillside.
Yes.
And in the background is like the skyline of two cities. Mm. And he's like, the two cities in the background are 16 miles apart. Where is the curve? Please explain this.
Oh, dear.
I know.
Mate, I mean, like, so obviously that someone could explain to him that you can't see the curvature of the Earth there.
Yeah, you have to be further and further away. Yeah.
But, like, I feel like he wouldn't take that on board. Well, so it's like well, would he? I don't know.
I mean, on Twitter, people were doing that.
Yes.
And, like, he was coming back and saying, oh, you know, no matter how high the elevation you are, the horizon is always eye level. I don't really get what that even means, but he had a whole series of pictures.
That doesn't mean anything.
He had this, one of the things he put up was a GoPro image,
yes,
which obviously a GoPro is like a fisheye lens.
Yeah.
And so it had like a massive curvature in it. And then underneath, and that was from quite high up, and then underneath was the same image that had been like corrected. The curve had been corrected.
Ah.
So the curve removed, the lens curve removed.
Yeah.
And it was just the horizon that began. It was straight line. And he's just like, that's it, sorted, argument over. It's like, doesn't mean anything.
That's bizarre.
It's amazing.
Yeah, like, I guess the only way to prove it to someone who's kind of got down that route is
to take them to space.
Yeah, or just a high altitude plane.
Well, I mean, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I was looking into it a bit more because I got interested in this whole thing. But there's like flat Earth societies are still like a thing. There's like proper like forums and websites, you know, the whole like organization surrounding this.
It's really
people
bizarre.
Who believe this stuff, and they think that like all space exploration and space science is just totally faked. Like the Hubble, there's like
every
people discussing,
just like there's another fake, another fake,
exactly.
Another fake. They're just wasting these rockets.
Yeah, just purely for the purpose of keeping like the wool pulled over our eyes.
As if like anyone cares.
Yeah.
Like why would people be maintaining that? That illusion that like we have to make sure they don't know it's flat. They have to think it's round. Like, what advantage does that confer to someone?
Yeah, and that's the other one of the other things B.O.B. tweeted was like this like series of apparently a lot of people who contributed to the spherical Earth theory.
Yes.
Back in the day, like all like Freemasons were all part of like some grand like plot to like again pull the wool over the eyes of the population.
I read something by the guy who like. One of the people who originally set up this Flat Earth Society thing, or like one of the modern ones, and he was interviewed on some news channel.
Yeah.
And he said something like, if the Earth is a sphere, like, why is there, like, there shouldn't be an up or down? Like, if there's not, and it's like, obviously, he just misunderstands gravity.
Well, he just doesn't, yeah. It's like he just hasn't read anything about anything ever.
I know, it's really weird.
It's a mental gymnastics involved in it. Like, to have a flat Earth invokes so many more problems.
Yes, it does. Yeah,
that apparently like the whole cosmos is like encased in like a ball where the flat Earth is at the bottom of it, and then you have like the sun and the moon are like embedded in the outside of this thing, and then the stars, and everything has to move in a very specific way to make sure you get the orbits of the planets that you can observe. I mean, it's just like there's so many more like levels of uncertainty and questions involved in believing that than there are in like actually just trusting what the evidence shows us to be true.
Yeah, it's just like a need for something to be like someone to be working against you or
yeah,
something like that, like some sort of weird kind
it's like a requirement to feel like you know the secret truth of something where nobody else knows.
Yeah.
It's weird, like part of psychology.
Yeah, it is weird. It's interesting.
It is. It's really interesting. But yeah, anyway, so that was, he's just quite a prominent example of these kind of, these people.
It was very amusing and very weird and good to see that it was like shut down largely by almost everybody.
Yeah, especially Neil Tyson, who just jumped in and was like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And I say, one of Neil Tyson's tweets, I can't remember exactly verbatim what it was, but it was something like...
He did a rap off against him or something, didn't he?
Yeah, he did something like that. But one of his like counter tweets was something like, don't worry, being five centuries regressed in your thinking doesn't mean we can't still like your music, or something like that. It's like, yeah,
it's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. No, I did enjoy that.
Yeah, it was decent. It was good quality. Anyway. Yeah.
Let's just hope it doesn't take over like the opinions of a general population.
I don't think there's much danger of that.
No, there's not.
No. But if you want to check out, there's loads of forums out there for like flat earth people, so go and check that out. It's good fun.
Yeah, if you want to laugh.
It's mainly just people trying to convince themselves that like satellites and the Hubble Space Telescope and the moon and pictures from orbit and all this stuff are like part of a big conspiracy.
Yeah.
And it's just quite funny to see them all run in circles trying to do it, but anyway.
Yeah, you kind of have to have like loads of other conspiracies right fold in to suggest that there's like this whole space program you've got to be thinking that it's for something else, like some secretive program. All these things being launched and flown into space, they think I must be, you know, working against us somehow, like, and that it's actually a cover for something, like chemtrails or trying to control our mind, all this bollocks. I don't know what those particular like flat earthers kind of view of the seemingly what I would think is like a necessary other conspiracy in order to explain why they're keeping the flat earthing secret.
Yeah, like what would be the benefit in their minds of the government the government's like every scientist in the world,
non-government aligned people,
what would be the benefit of keeping that secret?
I don't know.
Yeah, you're right, like so many things have to be like the case, like underneath it is built on so many layers of conspiracy.
Yeah
anyway,
yep, okay,
that sort of brings us to an end, so
thank you very much for listening.
Yeah, thanks again, and if you want to get in touch again, comments, and we'll be responding to more of them, so keep them coming. Love it.
We do indeed.
Oh yeah.
And on that note, I guess we'll see you guys next week. I'm not sure what are we doing next week.
We've got some ideas.
Okay, possibly
keep it a secret, should we say? I don't really know.
Well, let's say roughly it might be something to do with like the evolution of human intelligence, like what human intelligence is, and like some of the history of it, and sort of like what it means to be this intelligent and kind
of like why humans and like why now, essentially, like the whole history of life on earth and why now. So that's gonna be fun.
Yeah, super good.
So keep your eyes peeled.
Okay guys,
anyway, see you later.